So life, there are very few actual professional things that happened in my life that I planned. I certainly never planned to be a children's host. I had done Candid Microphone and radio 3 weeks after I graduated college with Alan Funt. And then I became a member of the Voice of America, State Department, in 1950, and then eventually went to Korea and became a war correspondent. And while I was there, I got married to an American lady, Gloria June Benson. And she flew over. We got married in 1953, and I quit the Voice of America. And I came back. We took a long 4 month trip around the world, as sort of our honeymoon. I came back to New York with a new wife and needing a job. So I went to see CBS, head of CBS News. He said, yes, maybe. Then he got fired the day after he interviewed me. Swear to God. Not because, I don't think it was because he, but he did get fired. So now I had a wife, no job, and no savings. We had spent that all on that 3 or 4 month trip around the world. But there was a new thing called educational television. And those stations hadn't gone on the air yet. But they were interesting. And one of the most interesting things is somebody in the VOA said they're looking for somebody to host a children's show in St. Louis, 45 minute shows a week to produce and host. I was totally qualified. I had never done television. I had never performed as a personality. And I had no interest in doing kids' shows. Perfect. So I wrote them a letter. And they sent me back and they were saying, okay, fly out here, we'll give you an audition. And I sent them back a letter in my most genuine manner. I don't have enough money to fly out. And for some reason I said, okay, we'll split the bill with you. So I did fly out and I did audition. And the man who was in charge of that took me to lunch after that audition and said, well, we've had a lot of people trying out for this show, and pretty much all of them have been smoother and glibber than you. I was not totally surprised by that. But then he followed by saying, but whatever it is you're going to become, I think you're just at the beginning, so if you want the job, it's yours. I give you this story again to show you how unpredictable life can be. If they said, you know, you don't get the job, yeah, who knows where I am. If I don't go to NYU and see, you know, go to textile, this doesn't happen. And yet here I am talking to you because you remember growing up watching Wonderama. I presume that's why most of you are here. Now, Wonderama was in itself an extraordinary moment in television time and in the history of our country in terms of who we were and what we were doing at that time. We had a limited number of outlets. New York actually had 7 stations, which was a lot. Most of the cities had 2 or 3. We only had 3 networks. And you had no other means of amusing yourselves outside the home on your own. No computers, no cell phones, no games you could play on computers and so on. So when you were watching television in those days, it was sort of all-consuming. Because the distractions available to you were very, very few. Now, a few years ago, I got a phone call from some people saying they had just bought Wonderama and were going to start a new Wonderama and they wanted me to be involved. I said, what do you mean, bought Wonderama? What was that? Well, we bought the title. I said, well, what do you think the title means? There was a Wonderama several before I took over. There was a Wonderama after I took over. Each one was totally different. And so what is it you think? Well, they kept calling me and offering me anything if I would stay attached. So I finally met with them. And I realized in going through that procedure that the chances of anybody being able to do again what we did in the 60s was just absolutely almost nil. Today, you suck the air out from between words because you're afraid that if you take a breath, what you have in your hand goes click and you're off. And because today the children have so many more opportunities to divert themselves with the computers, with the games, with the electronics, you know, there's a plethora of alternatives in their lives. And the idea that you can sit around and let that silence just hang in the air that I did when I talked with the kids is pretty much, you know, nil now. So I didn't want anything to do that. The other thing is, I know what I created, and I'm willing to live with that. I don't know what you're going to create, and I don't want to be responsible for that. So go with God, be good. You know, they're somewhere out there. I think they're on Channel 11 locally, and they are somewhere at 6 o'clock on Saturday night, and an hour show. I mean, it's not a terrible show. They sent me a print. But it's, you know, it's as far away from one Robinson being a kid show as you could get. It's constant energy being exuded, constant bombardment of impulses and stuff, so that nobody would turn you off. The other thing was, remember, in those days, you didn't have an automatic turner. So you were sitting on your sofa or your bed, wherever you were when you were watching. If you wanted to get rid of it, you had to get up and walk over to the television set and turn it off and turn on those. That was already too much trouble. So that was another factor in what we were able to do. And then we had all those hours. But the other factor that I realized, did not realize until I wrote my book, was that one of the things that made my show, our Wonderama show, different. Well, let me explain. There were three other shows on the network, on the station. As you know, there was Soupy Sandy, Sandy Becker, Chuck McCann. Incidentally, Soupy, Sandy, Sonny, and Chuck. I used to say, there's not a decent first name among us, you know. Now, Sandy and Soupy and Chuck were great entertainers. And the kids loved them, as well they should have. But the kids were their audience. And these people had immense talent. They did puppets, they threw pies, whatever they did. They were there to entertain you, and you were entertained by them. The hidden asset I have, or have, is I have absolutely no talent. I don't sing, I don't dance, at least not so you want to watch it. I don't make puppets, I don't throw puppets. What did I have? I had 4 hours. I had a studio full of cameras and cameramen and a director and me, and no production budget. And what the bloody heck was I going to do with this new show? He called me up and said, please, we want to raise the intellectual level of the show that's currently on. Would you be interested? Well, I had already done a series for CBS in the 50s, Let's Take a Trip, which was a pretty prestigious show. Didn't get a lot of ratings, but it was pretty prestigious. It was the first actual weekly remote location show done on television. And in those days when we did research, remote, I mean, the cameras were the same cameras we had in the studios, the big, big cameras trundled on those tripods. And the coaxial cables were yay thick. And you went out into these locations and you had to set up, that was amazing. And there was always a camera was going to go out at some point during the show. And you always had to be adaptable on a live half hour. Anyway, I had done that. And did I want to be in a show that had cartoons, a local show? I had a lot of misgivings about that. But then I figured, okay, I'll try it. And it took me maybe a few months to figure out what Wonderama could be. And then I realized, it was you. It was my asset in that studio with the kids. And the interior lives you all had. And when I figured that one out, and I realized that if I could gain your trust, and if you felt my respect, I could get inside your heads. I could listen to you. I could find out what was going on there. And that became the essence of Wonderama. And I have a few clips today that sort of remind you about where we were. Some of you may have seen these, they're on my website. But it's always fun for me and for you. Now, the sound is a little, in this cavernous auditorium, a little tough. I hope you can hear what was going on. The first clip coming up, I call Little Brown Eyes. I don't know her name, and I've never heard from her again. But it's my favorite. Why is it my favorite? Watch this, and you'll see the intimacy that we were able to develop. Her total trust in sharing with me her life in the regard that we were talking about. And how the studio has melted away. The cameras are gone, the lights are gone, and the other kids are gone. There's just Little Brown Eyes and me having this conversation in the middle of a television studio. So, okay, turn the lights down, if you will, and roll the first clip.
I think I know who I'm going to marry.
You think you know who you're going to marry? Come here. I don't want word to get around here. Who are you going to marry?
My friend. He's in my class. He used to be in my class. His name is Eric Webb.
Eric Webb? How old is Eric?
I think he's 7 3/4.
Oh, he's older than you.
Yes.
Oh, it's always nice to know an older man. Why do you like him?
I don't know.
Well, what is there about him that makes him special?
Well, he's strong. And,
is he polite? Oh, he's not polite, but he's strong, yes.
But when I'm in school with him, I go to his lunch table, and I sit with him, and he's always playing with his friends, and he's always talking about fresh things, and he's always like, if he had some bread, he would stick his finger through it.
Oh, he sounds like a delightful person. Well, Eric, is that his name?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Well, I hope you and Eric are remain good friends for a long time. Is he still in your class?
No.
Do you see him at all?
Sometimes, at lunch.
At lunch. You look forward to lunch, huh, to being able to see him. Well, I think Eric is very lucky to have a friend like you. And I hope you remain good friends, okay?
Mm-hmm. And he's very small, but he's very cute.
Okay. I think I like Eric, and I've never even met him. You're small, but you're cute, too.
I was going to bring him over, but my sister, she was so nutty. She lost 2 tickets, and I had to let her borrow one of mine, so I couldn't invite him.
Oh, that's dreadful. I would have enjoyed meeting Eric. Would you come back someday and bring Eric with you?
Yeah.
I hope so. We'll make arrangements for that, okay? I certainly would like to meet Eric. Matter of fact, would you like to take a present home to him?
Why?
Do you think he'd like a Hebrew National snack pack?
He's not Hebrew.